As you have come by faith to know the Christ who is ruler over all, as you by faith have come to know Him, now there's a way that you are expected to live on behalf of Christ Jesus. Don't get trapped by the philosophies of the world. And there are many of them out there today. There is nothing new out there. Any philosophy that is being projected or taught in our society today, whether it's on the TV or the talk shows or books or wherever, every philosophy is the resurrection of an old philosophy. There's nothing new. And we can just about take everything that's being said and go back to some time in history and say, see, it was taught way back then. It's old, and there's really nothing new. Don't get trapped by them in the way that you think, in the way that you live. And then he goes on to say that in this Christ, in relationship with this one person, you have been given the power of a life that can be lived before God in a way that is pleasing to Him. And you can experience, in knowing Christ, very unusual strength. That's what the Bible says this morning. Well, what is the Bible really all about? If I asked you this morning, walked up to you and said, what do you think the Bible's about? What might you say? Most would say, well, isn't the Bible about religion? And maybe there'd be some truth in that. And I looked it up in Webster's. Webster said this. He says, religion is a system of beliefs and practices relating to the sacred and uniting its adherents in a community. And I think that could be true. That's what a religion is. Doesn't much matter who you worship. You believe a common thing, and then you are a community. Now, when it comes to Christianity today, we might struggle a little bit with the uniting part. But certainly you could say that Christianity is a religion. But I do not believe that that's what the Bible is about. How about morality? From the law of God in the Old Testament to the wisdom literature of David and Solomon to the Sermon on the Mount, the words of Jesus preached 2,000 years ago to the epistles of the Apostle Paul and Peter and John and Jude and others. Certainly you're going to get morality out of the Bible, but you know what? The Bible is not about morality, because I'll tell you what, if you're determining to live by a moral code, you're probably going to end up living a life of a lot of guilt. Because guess what? You'll never measure up to what you believe you ought to be. Frustration and guilt. So I don't believe that this book is necessarily about morality. Thirdly, how about politics? Well, certainly, our nation and other nations have been governed by the Ten Commandments for hundreds of years. And certainly you can look into the Bible and you can find things that relate to politics and how nations are to be governed and laws are to be made. But you know what? The Bible is not a book about politics. And it's unfortunate when we look at our nation today that they have looked at the Bible and said, you know what? Because of what the Bible teaches, it's not really acceptable in the political sphere. Well, it is acceptable, but it isn't really about politics. So what is the Bible all about? And the Bible speaks about all those issues, religion, morality, and politics. But what's it really all about? I believe this morning. The Bible is most concerned from page one of the book of Genesis to the last chapter and words of the book of Revelation with a person. A person. And that person's name is Jesus Christ. And it is through the coming of and the redeeming work of this person that we call Jesus that we come to know and experience the living God. And through knowing the living God, we come to have the promise that He makes of eternal life. I don't know about you this morning, but I like to live eternally. I mean, I'm getting up there in years, and I'm getting to that age when things aren't as easy as they used to be. David wanted to challenge me yesterday to go through that obstacle course. Now, for him, it might be an issue of winning or losing. For me, it might be an issue of life or death. And so eternity is always on my mind these days. As the body begins to fail and begins to get older, you start thinking about things more often. And eternal life is the whole issue of going from this life into living in the presence of God for eternity. And it's a quality of life that's, according to the scriptures, according to this book, is something that we come to know now. Bible says in 1 John chapter 5 that he that has the Son has the life, and that he that does not have the Son of God does not have life. Oh, why are we a church and why are we here preaching in West Allis? Because we want the people of West Allis to know that this book called the Bible teaches us how to have life. Jesus said, I have come that they might have life, and that more abundantly. Jesus, who is the fullness of the living God, come in the flesh, is head over everybody and everything. He is the central figure in the universe, and he is the central figure in the scriptures. And that if you learn to understand and read this book, you will gain a deeper understanding about this man called Jesus Christ. The promise of his redemption is from the beginning of the Bible to the very end. And what is our response to that supposed to be this morning? How should we hear this word and understand this book, and how should we respond? It's simply this. As I read the Bible and I read the pages of Scripture, which we all can do, if you can read or listen to a tape, I will read the Bible and I will do so looking for a fuller revelation and understanding of whom this Jesus is. And then I'm going to respond as his servant, because that's what Colossians chapter 2, 6 to 10 is all about. That as I know this Jesus on a deeper level, I then will respond and I will live my life as his servant. And I will experience this eternal life, this real living flowing through me to my family, to my church, and to the world. See, that's what the Bible is all about. And we began talking about how Jesus is the main subject of the scriptures, and how that his redemptive plan began right in the beginning of the Bible, Genesis chapter 3. You know the story of Adam and Eve, and how that God had laid before them the law, and they disobeyed. And because they disobeyed, God brought onto the creation the curse that you experience day by day. Everybody can look at the world out there, and you can look at your own life, and you could say, you know what? Things aren't like they ought to be. They just don't work out. You know, marriages don't work out. Families don't work out. Business doesn't work out. Our bodies don't function like they ought to. Sickness, disease. There's something wrong with the creation. And that is the result of a curse that happened in Genesis chapter 3. But before God pronounces the curse on man and woman, what does he do? The first thing he does is promise a redeemer. He says, I want you to understand that I am going to, and in the words of Paul in Romans chapter 8, I am going to put the creation into frustration and bondage. And I'm going to do so not just to punish, but I'm going to do so that they will experience the creation and this frustration and this bondage in hope of something better, in hope that everything someday is going to be turned around and changed. And we are going to be brought into the blessedness of God's life once again. Now you say, well, you know, why did God do that? Well, we understand that. We should understand when we have children. When our children go out and do something that they're not supposed to do, we discipline them, right? We ought to discipline them. But we discipline them not to just punish them for what occurred in the past. We don't leave it there. We discipline them in hope that there will be a change in their character, that there will be a change within their life. So God subjects the creation to this bondage and decay and cursing, so that in hope something someday will be changed. And from the very beginning of Scripture, that change is going to happen on the basis of a man that is to come. Now, understand this, that the scripture was recording history that began 4,000 to 6,000 years ago. And from the very beginning of that history, a man is expected to come. From the very beginning, it's written in this book. T. Austin Sparks said, from the very beginning, someone is demanded, someone is foreshadowed, someone is proclaimed, and someone is to be manifested in the midst of the nations. Now, when you look at this in comparison to all other religions of the world, except for Judaism, which had its roots in Christianity, this is where there's significant difference. Because none of them demands a restorer that will come in the image of the living God and make everything new. None of the religions of the world can do that. But from the very beginning, the Bible's looking forward to this messianic figure to come. The Bible is all about Jesus Christ. He's proclaimed in Abraham, probably the greatest man that ever lived. And I think there's about three or four religions that put their foundations in Abraham. Jesus is proclaimed in Abraham in Genesis 22:18, and through your offspring, all nations on the earth will be blessed. He's proclaimed in Jacob. I want you to go with me to Genesis chapter 49. And if you don't have your Bible here this morning, just listen. Genesis chapter 49, I want you to see that for thousands of years of the record of Scripture, that it has been looking forward to the coming of this one man, Jesus Christ. Genesis 49:10. And there, as Jacob is blessing his sons, he says, the scepter will not depart from Judah, nor the ruler's staff from between his feet, until he comes to whom it belongs, and the obedience of the nations is his. And you might have a version that says, until Shiloh comes, a messianic term referring to the Christ. Genesis 49:10, he's proclaimed in Jacob. He's proclaimed in Moses. You remember Moses? The Bible says that the Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your brothers, and you must listen to him. Now, you could ignore Moses and you could get in some hot water. Okay, and some of them did. But you must listen to this coming person. You must. It's a matter of life and death. You can't ignore him. Why is it that Jesus has affected more people in the world, more governments, more sociology, more philosophy? Because you must listen to him. There's a lot of people that we can ignore. And maybe today you'll come here and you'll listen to me and you'll ignore me. And that's okay. But you know, you ought to go back to the scriptures and learn that the voice in the scriptures is the voice of God. And you must listen to God. You must. You can lose everything else, but you must listen to God. He's proclaimed in David. I want you to see this psalm. This was written 3,000 years ago, 1,000 years before the coming of Christ. Go to Psalm chapter 2. Psalm chapter 2. David wrote this. David lived around 1,000 B.C. This is a prophecy concerning the Lord Jesus Christ. Over 400 and maybe many more than that prophecies concerning Christ were fulfilled when he came. 1,000 years this was written before he came. Psalm chapter 2, verse 6, I have installed my king on Zion, my holy hill. I will proclaim the decree of the Lord. He said to me, you are my son. Today I've become your father. Ask of me, and I will make the nations your inheritance, the ends of the earth your possession. You will rule them with an iron scepter, and you will dash them to pieces like pottery. Therefore, you kings, be wise. Be warned, you rulers of the earth. Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling. Kiss the Son, lest he be angry and you be destroyed in your way. For his wrath can flare up in a moment. Blessed are all who take refuge in him. written 1,000 years before the coming of Christ, as God proclaims that it is His Son that is going to enter into the world, and it is His Son that we must give account to someday. He is proclaimed in David. He's proclaimed in the last book of the Old Testament, Malachi. The Bible says, "See, I will send my messenger who will prepare the way before me. Then suddenly the Lord you are seeking will come to His temple." Didn't He do that? Didn't He do that when He chased the money changers out? The Lord you are seeking. He came, but they didn't recognize Him. And then Jesus Himself said in the book of Luke 24, verse 27, He began explaining to the disciples what was said in all the Scriptures concerning Himself. All of the Scriptures, this book, this Bible that we read, it's not just about religion, morality, politics, the environment. That's not what it's about. It's concerned foremost of all with a person, and that the people of the earth who have experienced the frustration of life come to know this person. And in coming to know this person, come to have life. Life here and now, and life eternally. It's the only way that it is going to happen. Jesus is the redemptive promise, the main subject of all of the Bible. When you read the Bible, you must look for that. That's what it's about. And as you read the Bible, you'll get a deeper and greater understanding of whom He is. A greater and deeper relationship with Jesus. Jesus said, "You diligently study the Scriptures because you think by them you possess eternal life. But these Scriptures testify of what? Me." It's all about Him. Also, from the beginning to end of Scriptures, you see these redemptive pictures. If you're not convinced yet that the Bible is all about Jesus, there are these redemptive figures, these types, these physical illustrations of who Christ is. And if you don't understand the promises, you can't miss these physical pictures. Who is Jesus in the Bible? Well, in the garden of Adam and Eve, He is the offspring that's going to crush the devil's head. That's who Jesus is. In Adam's nakedness, He's the clothing of righteousness for the guilt of sin. In Abraham's covenant, He's the seed that's going to bless the world. In the valley of the five kings, He is the high priest of Salem, Melchizedek, whom the New Testament said had no beginning or end. In Isaac, He's the sacrifice that God will provide. In the plagues of Egypt, He's the Passover lamb. We sang about the lamb that was slain. He is the Passover lamb that is slain, and as the blood was put on the doorpost, the destroyer passes over the house, and people are not destroyed because of their sin. The plagues of Egypt. In the wilderness, the Bible says that they drank from the spiritual rock, and that rock was Christ. In the tabernacle, He's the spotless sin offering. In the book of Ruth, He's the kinsman redeemer that buys you back from slavery. In Isaiah, the one born of a virgin, the suffering servant. In Jeremiah, the faithful shepherd, the righteous branch. In Ezekiel, He's the greatest temple, from out of whom His very person will flow rivers of living water. And in Daniel, He's the fourth man in the fire. And He is the angel, and don't miss who He is, whose face was like lightning, His eyes like flaming torches, His arms and legs like the gleam of burnished bronze, and His voice like the sound of a multitude. How did they miss Him when He came? Thousands of years of prophecies fulfill this. From the very beginning, this man is demanded. You know what? I don't know how we missed Him. I don't know why it took me till I was 21 years old to come to discover, as I read the Bible, not even going to church, who this Jesus was. And the Bible teaches us that in latter days, people are going to look to some type of messianic figure to create peace within the whole world and to solve all of our problems. But how do we miss whom this Jesus is? Oh, we need a great vision of what the Bible is all about. and who this Christ is today. Well, what is to be our response? What must we do? We are called as ordinary people. I think most of you are ordinary people. I see myself as an ordinary people, although some people think I'm not so ordinary and they might say derogatory things, but I see myself as pretty ordinary. I work a job. I work in a dye shop. I have a family, and I have children. I have grandchildren. We have all the problems in life that most of you are experiencing and have. I was part of the hippie generation, and I liked upbeat music, and you can tell I just love this music that we're playing up here. You know, so I'm an old rocker and just enjoy it thoroughly. As long as it today, of course, points to Christ. Why it took me 21 years, I don't know. But today, as you hear the word and you see that this book is about Christ, please don't miss him. Please don't miss him. It's a matter of life and death. What must we do? Well, we're called as ordinary people into a day-by-day relationship with God. That's it. We're to be able to get up in the morning, and from the very first minutes that we arise to the very end of the night, we can walk in a personal relationship with God, in a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. That's what the scripture is all about. This relationship gives each of us the potential to hear God speak, to understand what that means, but to hear God speak and respond in obedience as his servants. That's what it's all about. That's what it's all about. That's what's going to make the church today what it needs to be. And then experience his life through the power of the Holy Spirit, working in us and working through us. That's what it's all about. So what must we do? There's two things I put in your sermon notes. Number one, we must be moldable. We must be moldable. And that begins in one way, and that is with a relationship with Jesus Christ. You know, the Bible says that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. The wages of sin is death. In other words, we know what wages are, right? It's what you earn when you go and work for somebody. I've got about 15 employees, and at the end of the week, they don't come to me and they don't beg for their money. They expect their money. Because why? It's not a gift. It's not a gift. Well, sometimes I think it's a gift, but to them it's not a gift. They earned it. And I owe it to them. When the Bible says that the wages of sin is death, it's just saying that this is what you earned. This is just what you get. And what that means is eternal separation before God. But the Bible goes on, after saying that the wages of sin is death, that the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. There is no book. There's no person. There's nobody that lives today or ever has lived or will live that can make that promise a reality save for the one person, Jesus Christ, in this book called the Bible. The gift of God. What must you do? You must recognize today that there is a sin problem in your life. You must be willing to turn from that. In repentance, the Bible says that repentance and faith are to be preached throughout the nations. What does that mean? That means I must be willing to make a mental change in my mind, and I must come to stop trusting in my own goodness and begin to trust in the goodness and the righteousness of this one man, the Christ Jesus. Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 5 that he who knew no sin became sin for us that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Where we come to the place where we change our minds about who this Jesus is, we recognize our sin, and we accept by faith the righteousness of Christ. Romans 10, 9 and 10, that if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. That's what the Bible teaches. We must be moldable. We must be changeable. This idea comes out of a book in the Bible in Jeremiah. If you go with me in Jeremiah, he talks about the idea of being clay like in a potter's wheel. Go to Jeremiah chapter 18, verse 1. In your Bible, it is in the major prophets. Jeremiah chapter 18, verse 1. And he describes how we, as the people of God, are to be moldable like clay. And this is what he says in verse 1. This is the word of the word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord. Go down to the potter's house, and there I will give you my message. And so I went down to the potter's house, and I saw him working at the wheel. But the pot he was shaping from the clay was marred in his hands. I think most of you know what that means. You know, most of us know that we are not what we ought to be. We're not what we want to be. We're marred. So the potter formed it into another pot, shaping it as seemed best to him. Then the word of the Lord came to me, O house of Israel, can I not do with you as this potter does, declares the Lord. Like clay in the hand of the potter, so are you in my hand, O house of Israel. See, we have to be moldable. We have to be in a place in our life where we say, Lord, you know what? I'm going to allow you to shape me as your servant. You're the master, I'm the servant. I want you to shape me so that I will become a usable vessel to serve you. That means we must be different, must be willing to be different. And that really gets to the idea is that when we read this book, there's something very special that happens. God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, takes the words of this book, the words of Scripture, and he takes those words in the midst of our everyday life and all the things that we're encountering, whether good or bad. And he takes those things, and he takes this word, and he begins to shape us, and he begins to form us into a vessel that can be used by him in this world. According to the prophecies of the New Covenant, now that's the era of time that we live in today, the Bible says that I'm going to put a new heart in them. Most of us today need a new heart. And when I came to know Christ, 32 years ago, he gave me a new heart. Now, that didn't mean I needed a whole lot of training still, but the Bible says he takes from you a heart of stone and gives you a heart of flesh. What's the difference? Did you ever try to mold a stone? Can't mold it. You can't change it. I've been doing a lot of work in my yard, and I've been moving stones around. I want to tell you something. You can't bust a stone up very easy. It's unchangeable. But he says, I'm going to give you a heart of flesh. That means a heart that can be changed, a heart that can be molded. And he'll take you, and in the events of life, he'll take this word, and he'll mold you, and he'll change you, and make you and transform you into a vessel that he can use. So you must be moldable and be willing to be changed in your life. If you're not willing to be changed from where you are to what you ought to be, then you don't have eternal life. That's a sign. You better look at your soul's prosperity. Secondly and lastly today, we must remain in the master's hand. We must remain in the master's hand. We don't go out and choose the work that we want to do and say, God, this is what I'm going to do. This is what I want to do with my life. Would you please bless me? No, we don't choose it ourselves. The master doesn't say to the pottery, the cup he creates, go out and do what you want. No, he holds the cup in his hand and he uses it for his service. But go with me to the book of John, the Gospel of John chapter 15. And that's where we're going to end up today as we consider this idea of remaining in Christ, to be moldable and then to stay there in the master's hand to be used by him. Gospel of John chapter 15, I'm going to read from verses 4 to 7. Remain in me, by the way, the word remain in this first section of John chapter 15 is used 10 times. Remain means to abide, to stay in, to live in. It's a term, the Greek term used for housing, to live there. Remain in me and I will remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Jesus is the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If a man remains in me and I in him, he will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. By the way, that nothing isn't a little something in life. He says, apart from me, you can do nothing. What does that mean? You can do nothing that is worthwhile before God, no matter how good you think you are, no matter how good I think I am. What I do by myself is worth nothing before God. Jesus said, the flesh profits nothing, and that nothing is not a little something. If anyone does not remain in me, he's like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire, and burned. If you remain in me, and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be given you. This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. And so it's not the world's idea of a servant where he goes out and does the work by himself at the directions of the master. That there is to be a unity between you and God, that as the master goes out and works in the world, he works with you, he works through you, and by you to accomplish his purposes. That's really what the Christian discipleship is all about. It reminds me of a story in the Olympics. And I saw it portrayed several times on TV in the last several weeks. It goes back to the 1992 Barcelona Olympics. The Olympian was a British Olympian named Derek Redman. Derek was running the 400 meters for the gold medal. And the gun sounded and he took off running full speed. And partway through the race, about halfway through the 400 meters, his hamstring ripped in two. And he went crashing to the track, and he got up and tried to run, and his leg was swinging wildly, and he kept falling back down. Suddenly from the crowd, a large man comes running out, throwing the security guards aside. Jim Redman went out onto the track, Derek's father. And he went over to his son, he grabbed his son, he said, "Son, you don't have to do this." And his son looked up at his dad and said, "Dad, I've got to finish. I've got to do this." And his dad said, "Well, then, son, we're going to do it together." And he picked up his son and he put his arm around him. And off they went, staying in the lane, down the track, alternately Derek burying his head in his father's shoulder. And they finished and they completed the race to a standing ovation of the crowd. And they cheered and cheered. Derek Redman did not get a gold medal that day. But he got something greater. He got the assurance of a father that would not stay in the stands and watch his son suffer, but that he would go down there and be with him and help him finish the race. See, we have a Father in heaven that in the midst of our lives, in the midst of our suffering and all those things that don't work out, doesn't stay in the stands, but he comes out and he joins the race with us. To work in us, to work through us, to accomplish his purposes. And we're assured that he will get us in this race of life to the finished line. And there will be in that day a host of angelic creatures cheering because what? Because the Father finished the race with each and every one of us. Do you have a relationship with Christ this morning? Are you moldable? Are you willing to have him change your life and make you into a usable vessel? And then if you're here today, you're already a Christian, will you then remain in his hands to be moldable? And will you take this book called the Bible and will you begin to read it from beginning to end, looking for a fuller revelation of this one man, Christ Jesus? There's no one in the universe that's like him. There's no one that we must answer to in the universe save this one man. He is the Son of God, the living Lord. And through coming to know him, we can have eternal life today. The Bible is about one person. It's not just about religion, morality, and politics. It's about Jesus Christ. Do you know him this morning? Your eternity is at stake. Let's pray. Father, thank you today for life. Thank you today that you gave us a record of what it means to have life. Lord, today as I think about the gospel and the churches and the divisions and all the things that happen out in the religious world today. I am reminded that it isn't about all of that. It's not even about others, but it's about you, the Lord Jesus Christ. And today, as we each sit here and have heard the Word of God, have worshiped, and now are praying, Lord, I pray that you would speak to each and every heart here today. They know who you are. They've heard the Word, and they know where they need to make adjustments and to be changed. And I pray today that there would be those that are in this body today, at this moment, that would come to know and believe on your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And may they then be changed and be moldable and remain in the Master's hand to be used for your glory and experience eternal life. In Jesus' name we do pray.